Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Shades Crest Baptist Church. The Bible tells us that this is the day that the Lord has made, and we are encouraged to be glad in it. Now, as I was coming to the this time of worship here together, I was thinking, how are we to be glad in such a situation as this one we're having right now in the world? And I was thinking, thinking about ourselves, I was thinking, how are we going to be glad when we cannot even have everybody here on the stage that we would like to have? We can't have a congregation here to worship with us. We're going to have people worshiping from their homes. The room is empty. We look everywhere and we don't see the people that we normally see here. And so how are we going to be glad? And then I was thinking, when we worship, we truly are worshiping God. He is the one who needs to be here to receive the worship that we present to him. And he is here in this place, in this very room. And he is with you at your home right there. You can be in God's presence. And that's all it takes. So let's join our hearts together. Let's be aware of God's presence with us. And let's worship him, let's praise him. So that being said, Chris, I'm going to turn it over to you, and you lead us from here.
Our scripture reading this morning will be from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 28 through 31. And it says this, "Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary. And his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youth grows tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." So even in this time of sickness, let's trust the word of God and let's worship the God of the word and let's sing, whether you're at home on the stage, we're going to worship the Lord this morning together and sing Everlasting God.
Rain for
there comes a time when I would like to invite you to join me in the reading of the 23rd Psalm. You will see the words on the screens, and I'm going to encourage you to read out loud as I read it from here. So from your home, just join in the reading, and let's get to the reality, being reminded of the truth that God is indeed the shepherd of our lives. So let's read it together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So let me invite you now to bow your heads in prayer where you are, and let's go to God's presence now, and let's present all that's going on in our lives, all that's going on in our community, in our state, all over the world, and ask God to confirm his presence with us, being the one who leads us to still waters, being the one who cares for us, who watches over us, being the one who indeed is our shepherd. So let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we come to your presence this morning to acknowledge that you are the everlasting God. You are the same God of yesterday. You are the same God of our days today. And you are the God who will remain God for eternity. And Lord, we know that in times of uncertainty, like the one we're having right now, we know that your presence will bring a sense of direction and comfort to us. In times when we feel like we're getting weak because of the doubts that we have within us, we know that you can bring strength to our souls. We know that when anxiety is trying to dominate our lives, you assure that your presence with us will take us to this oasis where we can rest and know that you can do all things and that for you nothing is impossible. So, Lord, we come to you today to tell you that we trust you. To say I'm sorry for the times when we live as if our faith is getting weaker. But when we cling to you, we know and we experience your strength in our lives. And we know you lead us. We know you care for us. We know that even during our sleep, during the night, you watch over us. And you remain God. You are present. You are caring for us. And you are very close to us as our Emmanuel, God with us. So, Lord, we come to you this morning to tell you that we love you, that we praise you, that we want to worship you with the entireness of our lives, and that we trust you to lead us when we don't know what the next step is going to be, because you are our shepherd. In Jesus' name we come to you and pray. Amen.
All the way, my Savior, who have I could I doubt his tender mercy? Who through life has been my guide? And all the way my Savior leads me and cheers each winding path I tread, and gives me grace for every trial, and feeds me with the living bread. And you lead me and keep me from falling. You carry me close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will follow me. And all the way my Savior leads me, oh, the fullness of His love. And know the sureness of His promise in the triumph of His blood. And when my spirit clothed immortal wings as fly to realms of day, and this my song through every age, and Jesus led me all the way, and Jesus led me all the way. 'Cause you lead me and keep me from falling. You carry me close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will follow me. 'Cause you lead me and keep me from falling. You carry me close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will follow me.
Ram, thank you and the praise team for leading us in worship this morning. Tech team, thank you so much for being here to record these services. And good morning to all of those of you who are watching this morning. I'm not sure who might be watching, so let me introduce myself. I'm Mark Johnson, associate pastor here at Shadescrest Baptist Church. Our pastor, Brian Lee, and his wife, Clella, are both recovering from the flu. He's doing well. They're both doing well and recovering well, and should be back at it next week. But they couldn't be here this morning, so I am preaching here in his place. They do want to let you know they have everything they need. They do not need anyone to bring them meals or to go out and buy them groceries. They really want to maintain the social distancing that we're being asked to do. And so they just wanted me to let you know they're doing well and they appreciate all of your prayers. Well, this has been a trying week for all of us. Many businesses, restaurants, entertainment venues, and churches have been asked to close in order for all of us to do all we can to stem the tide of this horrible disease. This week, we closed our church office for the first time in our 56-year history. I want you to know that we have not, nor will we, stop being church. You are the church, and you have done so much already this first week, and I commend you for it. Your church staff is working to identify how we can continue to minister to the needs of our congregation and community during this pandemic. This week, our young adults delivered 200 bags of food to Green Valley Elementary School for children who might have otherwise gone hungry. Other volunteers and church leaders are reaching out to our older adults to ensure that they have the groceries, medicines, and anything else that they might need. Others in our community have finished preparations of our missionary residents in case a missionary family is in need of housing. And our Connect group leaders and members are reaching out to all of their groups, making sure that each person has everything that they need and that we maintain our contact with each other. If you know of anyone who may have fallen through the cracks, please call our church office. The office phone will be forwarded to one of our administrative assistants who will direct your call as needed. Our phone lines will be open according to our regular business hours, Monday through Thursday, 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. No one knows what lies ahead for us. These are difficult days that none of us have ever seen before. It's a time for all of us to do our part for the community, our nation, and the world. I pray that your faith in God will remain strong and that you will look to Him for your comfort and strength. So along those lines, I'd like to share with you a message this morning that I pray will give you encouragement, hope, and peace. I ask you to open your Bibles to Exodus chapter 14. In this account from Exodus, the Israelites have left Egypt after much anguish and travail. Pharaoh resisted allowing the people to go free, but after God sent plagues upon the nation and against him, Pharaoh finally allowed the people of Israel to go. God led the people out of Egypt, showing them the way with a pillar of cloud leading them in the daytime and with a pillar of fire leading them by night. God wanted them to know his protection and his covering over them. He wanted them to know his presence with them. And he wanted them to know that they had nothing to fear. Everything was going well until Pharaoh had a change of heart. He decided he did not want to let the people go after all. Even though they had already left his nation and were well on their way to the promised land, he decided that if he could not have them as slaves, no one could have them at all. So he gathered his best soldiers with his best chariots, and he went out after the people of Israel. Suddenly, the safe and free exit from Egypt became an even greater crisis for the Israelites than had been their slavery. They were seemingly trapped with the Red Sea out before them and the Egyptian army coming up from behind them. God sent them word through his servant Moses, and that is where I would like to pick up the story this morning in Exodus chapter 14. Reading Exodus 14, verses 13 through 14, Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance of the Lord. You will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. Pharaoh wanted the people of Israel to belong to him. He wanted them as his slaves. But these people belonged to God. God was never going to let them go, and he was not going to let anything harm them. And so it is that God tells his people to stand firm. He tells them to be quiet, to listen, to hear what he has to say to them. And so I bring us to this first point in our message this morning. In troubled times, look around you. In troubled times, stop and look around you. Moses told the people of Israel, as they stood there seemingly trapped between the Egyptians and the Red Sea, that God would fight for them. They probably wanted to take up their weapons and fight against the Egyptians themselves. But God knew this was not the way. This would only lead to more bloodshed, more lives lost. He knew that the right thing for them to do was to wait upon him. He had a plan, and he had a way for the people to go. All God asked of his people was to stand firm, to be still, and to wait on him. That's what he's asking of us today. He's asking us to be still. He's asking us to stop and listen and hear what it is that he is trying to tell us. The best translation of this word, this Hebrew word that it in our scripture today that tells the Israelites to be still, is actually to hush, to be quiet. In these difficult days, that may be one of the most difficult things to do, to settle our spirit, to be quiet, to be still. But unless we learn how to do that, we cannot hear what God has to say to us. And that's what he wanted the Israelites to know. He wanted them to know that he was at work. He was going to fight for them. And all they had to do was to be still. That's why I'm proposing that we take time today to thank God for his blessings, for the gifts that he's given us, for his peace, his rest, his joy. Sandy's mom, we call her Mom, that's her grandmother name, has a wonderful spiritual practice of gratitude. She calls it her blessings jar. All throughout the year, she drops notes into her blessings jar. Moments that she sees God at work in her life. Moments she doesn't want to forget. Then at Christmas or January, maybe for her birthday, sometime late in the year when all the family is gathered together, we'll sit in a family circle and pass the jar around from one family member to the next, each of us reading some of the blessings that she has tucked away throughout the year. It's a magical moment, a very special time. Perhaps you have a jar or container of some kind around your house that you could use as a blessings jar. I found a few examples that might help you. This jar is a vase, could be used as a blessings jar. I found this tin can that could be used as a blessings jar. Or maybe even that sand and garden playset. We might not be able to go to the beach for a long time, but we can get out our sand castle building bucket, or whatever you might call it. This could be a great container for our blessings. I've written one for today. I used paper that I had around the house, just a pad of paper. I don't want to send you all out to the grocery to buy things so that you can have a blessings jar. I want you to be creative, and I know that you will be. But I'm taking this blessing that I've already written, Saturday, March 21. I want to thank God for the sound team. For our praise team, for Aram, for my wife, and for the technologies that God has given us to be able to put this service on the internet for you to enjoy. And so I'm going to put this blessing in my blessings jar today. This might be something that could be helpful for your family as you have a little bit more time together. Another idea is one that I borrow from Fred Rogers. You know Mr. Rogers. He once taught his young audience about a very important thing that we can do in difficult times. He said, "When I was a boy and I would see scary things in the news, my mother would say to me, 'Look for the helpers. You will always find people who are helping.' In these troubled times, stop and look around you. See what God is doing. See the people around you that God is using. See the people around you who you might be able to help. Look for the helpers." And so I encourage you to look for the helpers today. Pray for our helpers. Pray for our nurses, physicians, firefighters, police officers, our grocery workers, those who are continuing to work while we're asked to stay home. Pray for them and pray that God will protect them in these difficult days. I confess, times like these are not easy for me. In the last few weeks, I've been all tied up in knots. Like you, I've tried to maintain my daily spiritual practices, but it has been difficult. I'm troubled by what I see on the news, so I try not to watch it. I'm disturbed by so many people who are ill and those who have lost lives and lost loved ones. And it touches me in the depths of my soul. I imagine many of you feel this same way. I just wish there was something I could do. Activity is good. And I shared with you some examples of what our church has been doing. And when I say church, I mean the people of our church. Some of the things they've been doing this week to help others, and I hope it will inspire you to do the same. But even though this activity is good and helpful, it doesn't make the angst and uneasiness go away. We must take our anxiety to God. He is the only one who can take our cares from us. In 1 Peter, we are reminded to cast all our anxiety on Him because He cares for us. Like the Israelites, it is time for us to look to God and to trust Him, believing that He will make a way for us. He made a way for the Israelites by dividing the Red Sea so that they could walk through it on dry ground. The most unimaginable solution. What solution might God have for you today? I don't know, but I know that if you stop and look around you and see Him and listen for Him, you will hear what He wants for you to do. Second, in troubled times, I encourage you to look within you. Turning now to Mark chapter 4, we see Jesus with His disciples. They and some other followers are about to set out across the Sea of Galilee. Jesus may know exactly what is about to happen. I'm not sure if He did or not. But He told the disciples to get into the boat and to go on to the other side. And as we read this story from Mark chapter 4, we'll see what happens next. So reading from Mark 4, verses 35 through 41. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was, in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." This storm that came up on the Sea of Galilee was not an uncommon appearance or occurrence. The men who were in this boat, many of them were fishermen. They'd seen squalls like this come up before, yet they were terrified in this particular instance. Perhaps this storm was like none other that they had ever experienced before. However, this case was also different in that there was one in their boat more powerful than the storm. Had they forgotten this? Had they forgotten the power in Jesus' words and in his person sleeping in the back of his boat, of their boat? Maybe they did forget. Or maybe in this crisis, their faith simply failed them. That is certainly understandable. As I shared with you earlier, I've had some struggles this week. It's a reminder that whenever we take our eyes off Jesus and focus on the storm, we will fall and fail. When I was feeling this deep unrest in my soul, I reached out to a few of my friends, the prayer team, actually, asking them for their prayers and for their encouragement. And they did just that. They prayed for me. They prayed for our staff. And through their prayers and encouragement, I felt God's strength within me. I hope that you are also reaching out to friends, your connect groups, your connect group leader, your pastors, our church staff. We are here to help you. But this point is about looking within. And within you, I'm not asking you to find strength of your own. No. Our strength will always fail us. The only one who is faithful and true, the only one who can see us through times like these, is our Lord and Savior. The one who with but a whisper can calm the seas. If you've been reading Trevor Hudson's book, Pauses for Lent, this is the book we suggested the church use as a guide for each day through the Lenten season. I've been reading that as well, but I got behind, and when I got caught up here at the end of this week, I found this wonderful expression of truth on the pages of day 21. I think that was Friday's devotional. The word for the day was peace. The scripture was from John 14:27. "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you." And I don't want to read this entire devotional. I hope that you've already done that. But I want to read from this second paragraph, where Trevor Hudson tells us that God's peace is a lasting peace that cannot be taken away. It does not depend on our lives running smoothly. God's peace provides an inner assurance that ultimately all will be well. This peace occurs in the presence, not the absence, of upheaval and turmoil. This peace is not the peace the world gives. It's the peace that God gives. And it's the peace that He has already given us. If only we will look within and trust that God is with us, He is present. He is with us. Yes, the disciples failed their mini faith test. Truth was resting peacefully in the back of the boat, and they were terrified for their lives. John reminds us that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We must find our trust and our rest in Him and in Him alone. He is right here with us in the boat. And if it appears to you that He is asleep, He is not. Psalm 121 tells us that He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, He who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. He is right here in the boat, waiting for you to call out to Him. He will make a way for you to ride out this storm, and He will be there with you through the storm, and He'll be there with us when we come out on the other side. I'm reminded of the Scott Crepane song, "Sometimes He Calms the Storm." The chorus for this song goes like this: "Sometimes He calms the storm with a whispered, 'Peace, be still.' He can settle any sea, but it doesn't mean He will. Sometimes He holds us close and lets the wind and waves go wild. Sometimes He calms the storm, and other times He calms His child." In these troubled times, it is important that we look within and see that God is already there. If you are afraid, look to Him to be your strength and shield. If you are anxious, cast all your cares upon Him, knowing that He is the one caring for you. If you are grieving, lean on Him and He will comfort and carry you in His arms. If you are weary, go to Him with your burdens, and He will give you rest. And if your faith is wavering, call upon Him, and He will help you through the storm. Finally, in these troubled times, I encourage you to look above you. When Jesus neared the end of His life, He was troubled in His spirit. He went to a quiet place to pray. But this time he took His friends with Him. Reading from Mark 14, verses 32 through 36. They went to a place called Gethsemane. And Jesus said to His disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with Him. And He began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," He said to them. "Stay here. Pray with me. Keep watch. Be with me." Then, going a little farther, He fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from Him. "Abba, Father," He said, "everything is possible for you. take this cup from me. Yet, not what I will, but what you will. In this season of Lent, as we prepare for the celebration of Easter, let us not forget the agony Jesus endured for us. When he was faced with his final struggle, he cried out to his Father for the strength required to finish the work he had come to do. Like the Israelites, Jesus had reached the end of the road. Like the disciples, he was in the midst of his own personal storm. And in the midst of this, his greatest crisis, he looked up to his Father for help and strength. He looked around to his friends, asking them to stay with him in prayer. He looked within himself for his faith and called out through that faith to his Father. And he looked up above, submitting himself to his Father's will, praying, "Not my will, but yours be done." I pray we will all look within our hearts and choose to live our faith even in these troubled times. Look around you and see that you're not in it alone. There are so many people ready to help and others who you may be able to help along the way. I pray we will all look up. Look up to God, for he is the only one who is already beyond these days. He is the one who is making a way for us to pass through the waters on dry ground. He is the one who, with a mere breath, can speak forth peace and stillness. He is the one who right now stands on the other side of the grave with his arms open wide, ready to break down the barrier of our social distance from him, ready to hold us in his arms, to hold us tight with his warmth and love. I pray that you will put your lives in his hands today. I pray that you will put your hand, your heart, your life in his hands today. And the next time that you stand at the sink washing your hands, I encourage you to sing this 20-second song. He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 As our praise team comes now to close out our time together in worship, I ask you to join me in prayer as I lead us in praying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, I leave you with this blessing from Romans 15. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of his Holy Spirit.
Well, this is usually the part of the service where I ask everyone to stand, but seeing as circumstances are different, no matter where you are watching this service, you're welcome to stand, remain seating, and sing if you want to, no matter what. Just worship the Lord wherever you are, because he is a God that meets us wherever we are. So let's sing together as we close the service. Great is thy faithfulness.
Beginning to end, my life in your hands. Great, great is your faithfulness. You never let go. This one thing I know, the great.
Is faithful, and as we get to the end of this time together in worship of our God, let me remind you that the work and the ministry of the church goes on even as we face these very difficult days. So consider continuing to give to the ministry of the church. There are several ways you can do it. Of course, you're not here to bring your offerings to the office or to services as we usually do in many circumstances, but you can still give. You can mail your check. You can go to the website and consider online givings. If you have the church app on your phone, you would be able to do that. If you're not sure about how to do that, call the office number and you will be guided and somebody will help you to set it up and you'll be good to go about your giving. And let me remind you that all on-campus activities are suspended for the moment until further notice. So always go to the website. We're trying to keep all the information updated there. We're going to continue to send information via email. So you should receive from us all the information you need for these coming days when we don't know exactly what's going to happen and when we go back to normal life. But we hope that you will have this assurance in your life that God is present, that God is the everlasting God, that God leads us no matter what the circumstances are, that he is faithful and he is ever present with us. So I hope to see you next week. God bless you in the coming days, and may his presence be real to you every hour of your day. See you next week. Blessings to you all.